kind of to go back into that reason for the study, you know, I was kind of noticing some trends in our warning amounts where, you know, we would have warning amounts of, you know, in our warnings itself before we got any reports of like 1-inch hail, yet we would get a maximum hail report or a hail report of 1.75-inch hail or 2-inch hail or, you know, even a couple times here, like the 2.5 to 2.75 or, you know, that type of thing. So you definitely notice the, you know, under warning the hail size in that 1.75 to 2-inch range. So it kind of made me wonder, is there some way where I can leverage some of that information or from the MRMS mesh data to, you know, utilize in the warning operations? And this chart here just kind of shows if I took a look at, just the 2-inch or larger hail reports and what was our warning size in those situations. In this case, you know, 63% of our warnings had a max hail size of less than or equal to 1.5 inches when we had 2-inch hail, report. So, you know, definitely kind of a disconnect. You know, even if you look here, we had 5 warnings that mentioned we were going to see 1-inch hail, yet we received a 2-inch hail report. So, you know, it definitely kind of, you know, affected, or you can kind of see that difference in between the warning and the in the hail size reports that we were getting. So, you know, I kind of alluded to it, you know, could the MRMS mesh data, you know, aid in, you know, picking up on some of the higher end hail events or warnings that we've had. So this study kind of just focuses on the Aberdeen area for the last couple of years. We saw a pretty remarkable increase in the number of 2-inch hail reports in the Aberdeen area here just last year. Normally, I think the previous year we only saw about four instances, and then this past year we saw, I think it was like 18 or something like that. So definitely an increase. But before I kind of go into some of that, I just want to, you know, just provide a brief overview of some of the mesh and some of the past verification studies that have been done. So the mesh is maximum estimated size of hail, and it's kind of calculated for what's going to occur at the ground, what, you know, the mesh value would be at the ground. You know, one of the advantages of the MRMS data over, like, you know, what we'd normally see in the GR2 is it gives you the multiple radars. So you get, you know, multiple views of it and develops into that kind of 3D cube that they show in some of our MRMS mesh training. And so to come up with the mesh, there's a severe hail index. And that was created by Witt back in 1998, where he wanted to kind of come up with a, you know, a severe hail index to, you know, help out with some, you know, warning operations, or essentially kind of as a replacement to like the hail detection algorithm that we have with the radar. So he kind of took a look and used some of the similar ideas from the VIL, where the VIL kind of caps things out in that 50-55 dBZ range to reduce the influence of hail. He wanted to focus, you know, his, you know, algorithm on, you know, in that, you know, hail producing area or those higher reflectivities. So once he got above 50-55 dBZ and then kind of really ramped it up going into the higher ends. And then he also used the similar weighting functions, or added some weighting functions in there to, you know, weight the higher reflectivities where the colder temperatures are. So if we had, you know, temperatures aloft where the reflectivities were 60 or 70 dBZ, they'd be weighted higher if the temperatures are minus 20 C or minus 10 C than if it was 0 C. So kind of combine the two of those to create the severe hail index. And then the mesh is just calculated by taking the square root of that. So it kind of, you know, kind of fell out of that. And like I mentioned, it was originally developed for, you know, more of a storm base, but with the MRMS data, it's transitioned to more of a grid base. So it gives you a better idea of some of the aerial extent of the hail within the storm. And one of the big things to kind of keep an eye on, and a lot of this was in the MRMS mesh training, but, you know, just be aware of some of the situations where the MRMS mesh underestimates the hail size. Those highly tilted storms, you know, left-moving supercells, you know, situations like that where it can, you know, influence the hail size fairly significantly, and I'll show a couple of examples of that. So as for verification, there's been several verification studies, and all of them kind of point to the mesh really overestimating the hail size. So one of the ones, Wilson in 2009 used some of the shave hail data, so that high resolution, you know, actual ground report data where they went out and called several locations and overlaid that with the mesh data, and, you know, he found overall fairly limited skill in the mesh data. You can kind of see in the chart here, if we use the example of the mesh value, it's kind of tough to see, but, you know, 2-inch hail would be right around in this area, while, you know, what they were finding with actual hail reports on the ground is 2-inch hail generally ended up matching up with about 1-inch hail on the ground. So, you know, definitely was overdoing the hail size. But that's kind of tied into what, you know, Witt had kind of designed it for is it wants to be, you know, kind of the high end, or what's the maximum size that's going to be in that storm. And, you know, essentially 75% of the hail observations would be less than that mesh value. But one of the things that was found in 2006 study is that, you know, overall they kind of compared the MRMS mesh versus the hail detection algorithm and several other options, and they found the mesh performed, you know, better than what, you know, the legacy hail detection algorithm was, which, you know, we've all kind of seen is pretty poor and way overestimates things. So it's definitely, you know, an improvement. There's another study in 2012 where they wanted to create more of a hail climatology using the mesh data, and they found it to be fairly useful and successful. It was a kind of a shorter period, only a couple years worth of data that they did, but kind of the key point from it is they found a similar thing where the mesh kind of overestimates what the hail actually, you know, using some of the shave data too. They found that, you know, if you had a, you know, what they defined as severe back when we had the 3/4-inch hail severe criteria, you know, they would see a mesh value of generally around 1.14 inches for that severe or that 0.75 inch hail. So, you know, once again, the mesh was overestimating. So, you know, so, you know, a lot of the verification points to that overestimation, and, you know, some of the things I've seen in our Aberdeen study, it, you know, it's kind of a similar thing, but there are some interesting aspects to that. So what I ended up doing is I started looking at the 2-inch hail reports, you know, for last year, 2015, but extended it to 2014, and so we ended up having 22 2-inch hail reports. Like I mentioned before, most of those occurred last year, so pretty significant amount just in the last year. One of the reasons why I wanted to focus on the larger hail reports is the MRMS data, the archive MRMS data that I could grab from the OU page, unfortunately only goes out or only has data for past years every 10 minutes. So utilizing, you know, more of that 1.5 to 2-inch, or especially on the 2-inch or larger, you know, those are more established, you know, less of that pulse severe type stuff. If you're looking at more of the 1-inch hail, you know, you would have a larger potential of missing some of those, you know, increases in the mesh between the 10-minute data. So there is that caveat that, you know, yeah, it is only every 10-minute data, so I could miss some things, you know, with some of the values. But overall, looking at the trends, I think, you know, the general idea fit in pretty well with, you know, what I would expect with some of those storms. So here's this chart here. We've got on the left-hand side or the vertical column, we've got the MRMS mesh size, and then on the bottom is the our Aberdeen warning hail size. And this is just kind of looking at what the mesh value was when we issued the warning. So just kind of a starting point, you know, kind of a comparison. So if we look at, you know, we see a pretty large cluster there around the 1-inch, which makes sense. I mean, that's, you know, generally when we get that trigger to issue the warning, we're triggering on that 1-inch hail report. We do have some values farther to, you know, into the 1.5, 2-inch hail. Some of those were initial issuances, but a good portion of those were storms that had already been, you know, ongoing. We've gotten past reports, you know, that type of thing. So, you know, we trended to have the hail sizes up a little higher. But if you look just, you know, kind of a comparison of some of the mesh values, you know, there's some interesting things of, you know, some of these higher. We had even a situation where we had, you know, 2.3 or 2 to 2.35 or so inch hail in the mesh, but, you know, we had 1-inch as our starting point in the warning. So, you know, just looking at that, you can kind of see, you know, maybe there is something, some utility to, you know, kind of lead us maybe a little towards the higher end of the warning amounts, or at least bump our hail sizes up a little bit more. The other thing, there's two other things that I noticed, and unfortunately with doing it this way, don't have this drop in, so let me, I'll talk about this first here and I'll slide it all the way, but, you know, one of the things I noticed too, looking at our hail reports, is there's a pretty decent amount of larger, or a golf ball size, But if you look at 1.5 inch hail, we only had four. Yet, I mean, we had a pretty significant number of, 1.75 inch hail. So part of me wonders if some of these are maybe, could have been 1.5 inch or a little smaller, but they just kind of, if I think of, if I had a ping pong ball versus a golf ball, I was looking at it from a distance, would I be able to tell the difference? You probably more than likely would just go towards golf ball, since that's, a lot of our, one of our main amounts and that. So, it makes me wonder if maybe some of these values are a little, farther to the, or on the lower end side, but, still a fairly large amount. If I shift this, let me shift this out of the way. The other thing to kind of notice is, here on the bottom, there is a fairly large amount of MRMS mesh values where they were pretty low, and yet we got large hail. So we had, in this one, the mesh value was maybe only 0.6 or 0.7, but we had 2.5 inch hail. We had another one here where we had 2.75 inch hail with a mesh value, around 0.6. And a lot of these, going back and looking at these, I would kind of keep track of what type of, storm it was, if it was a, maybe a, highly tilted storm or a left split, that type of thing. And a lot of these kind of, these lower mesh values tied into those limitations that are with the mesh values. So, that's something that you definitely want to kind of keep an eye on or be aware of as those limitations. So if we step forward, and I'm going to have to move this out of the way here. Oops. If we step forward, if I pull out some of those limitations, we start to see things kind of focusing maybe a little closer to what you would expect, that, maybe get that one-to-one of the reported hail size to the mesh value. But, it's kind of interesting that overall, a lot of our, mesh values were lower than what our reports were. So that's kind of opposite of what some of the verification was. And I think part of that is tied to the fact that the way I looked at it is I just looked at what the largest hail size was in the storm, kind of going along more with the mesh versus, looking at grid point by grid point, which is some of what some of the other verifications have done. So, it's kind of interesting to see that difference in it. But one of the things I wanted to focus on is if we take a look inside this blue box, those are mesh values that are above 2 inches. So anytime I had a mesh value of 2 inches, I took a look and, okay, what was the hail reports that we got? And so that's where this chart here comes in is, what was the MRMS mesh values of 2 inches or above? Essentially, 69% of the cases that we had a mesh of 2-inch hail and we got a report, they were 2 inches or larger. So pretty good correlation with that. If you add in some of the golf ball reports, the 1.75, then you're up to 92% of the time if you saw, an area of a mesh of 2 inches in that storm, we got golf ball or larger hail. So I think that's kind of one of the keys to take from this is, when you're starting to see larger, 2-inch or especially more than one pixel of 2-inch hail in the MRMS mesh data, it's a pretty good shot that you're going to see, golf ball or larger hail. That's not always the case. I'll show you an example from yesterday here where we had some 3-inch hail reports with, lower mesh values. But, it definitely kind of highlights that idea. So now I'm just going to kind of give you some example cases, some of the items that I had used or the data that I had used for the study. This first one here, let me move this out of the way, was from one of our severe warnings that we issued back in June of last year. So the way we kind of follow through this is go kind of left to right, top to bottom. So I kind of stepped through it, kind of 10-minute time frames, giving what we had in the warning, what the maximum or the mesh value was at that time, and then that gives you the time. So for this first one, we issued the warning. We had 1-inch hail in there at the time. The mesh was 1.5 inch. We go 10 minutes later. The mesh was up to 2.3 inches. The warning at that time was 1.75, so definitely saw the trend in the increasing potential for larger hail, so the warning trended up. The mesh kind of continued the upward trend up to 2.7 inches 10 minutes later. The warning was still at 1.75 inch at that time. Right around that time, I guess it was more of a delayed report, but we got a 2-inch report at 18.05, so 5 minutes before that mesh value. of, you know, that 2-inch hail. So once we got that report at 1820, we updated the warning to 2-inch hail, and the mesh was at 2.3. So kind of the key point to take from this is, you know, using the mesh data, you know, kind of gave a heads up that there is a potential for some 2-inch hail in there, and maybe could have given us a little more lead time for seeing that, or getting, before getting that 2-inch hail report. We jump to the next example. Slide this up here. This was from essentially our big event, our July 17th event last year. Is, you know, pretty active event for us. This was a case where we kind of show both advantages and some disadvantages with the mesh. We had a, you know, very explosive environment for rapid development. So in this case, we issued the warning, you know, initially starting with 1.25-inch hail, but the mesh at that time was only 0.5 due to that, you know, the rapid growth of the storms. 10 minutes later, we trended the warning up to 1.5. The mesh was still trailing behind what we were showing in the warning, so we were picking up, we were recognizing the larger hail potential, you know, that we were seeing with the, you know, the raw radar data. If we go 10 minutes later, so this is 20 minutes after the warning was issued, we're still at 1.5-inch hail. We did receive a 1-inch hail report at that time. The mesh has shot up to 2 to 2.7 inches at that point, and then we were starting to get some larger reports. 5 minutes after that, we got a 1.75-inch hail, and then 5 minutes later, so at 22Z, we got several 2.5-inch hail reports, and then at that time, we updated the warning to 2.5-inch hail. So even in this case, you know, yeah, the mesh was trailing at the beginning, so, you know, we utilized that radar data that really helped us out, but, you know, the mesh started to pick up on that, that idea that, you know, we would have the potential for larger hail and kind of give a little bit of a lead time that 2-inch hail was possible in the storm. So, you know, kind of, you know, shows both ends of the spectrum there. This one, kind of the same thing. This one was actually kind of interesting. I was surprised it did so well. This was a, you know, left split on these storms here. So, you know, we had the 1-inch on the warning, 1.6 inches on the mesh, you know, go another 10 minutes later, we were still at 1-inch on the warning, up to 1.8 inches on the mesh. 10 minutes later, still at 1-inch on the warning, but the mesh is up to 2.9 inches at that time. Then we got a couple reports of 2-inch hail about 5 to 10 minutes after this last update on the warning. And so then, you know, we updated the warning to go up to 1.75 inch hail. So in this case, you know, the mesh definitely gave us a good, you know, 10, maybe even, you know, 15 minute heads up that, you know, 2-inch hail was possible in the storm. So, and then here's an example of a false alarm, but, you know, I mean, truly, to me, this is a verified event. We had a 2-inch hail report. Here, we already had received a 2-inch hail report, so when we issued the warning, we were up to 1.5 inch for the storm off to the west of that, that 2-inch report. You know, we go through time, 10 minutes, you know, the mesh was still kind of trending up. We had the 1.5 inch. We trended the warning up to 2-inch. The mesh at the same time was trending up to 2.5 inches, continued that 2-inch hail in the warning, which was really good, but, you know, it just happened to be in the middle of nowhere, a lot of grasslands and maybe a few cattle or pheasants or that type of thing. So, you know, really nothing there to help, you know, with the verification. But to me, that's, you know, well-warned and, you know, the warning operator did a good job kind of keeping up with things. And this last one here, let me move this out of the way. This was a severe and tornado warning that we had issued on a storm back in 2014. But the interesting thing with this case is the mesh at the time that we got the hail report and we had a tornado occur was at 0.2. So it made me wonder, it's okay, well, why is it at 0.2? So I took a look at some of the storm top information from the MRMS. It's indicating about 30, maybe a little above 30,000 feet. So, you know, definitely a, you know, low top types supercell. You look at, you know, the cross section here, you can kind of see the same thing, very highly tilted. Supercell, so, you know, that's one of the limitations with the mesh is it doesn't do well with low-topped or highly tilted storms. So, you know, that tied into it. But one of the other interesting things was I looked at the radar quality index, and for some reason, Aberdeen's located here. That's where the radar is. But for some reason, the Aberdeen radar dropped out of the MRMS data at this time. So with the fact that we were using the Mayville and then the Sioux Falls radar, it, you know, and the fact that it was a really low top storm, I mean, you weren't really sampling it that well, and that so that had a pretty significant influence on some of the MRMS data. So, you know, just another thing to kind of keep in mind of some of those limitations. And a lot of those times where I saw, you know, really low mesh values with stronger storms were, you know, those highly tilted storms, you know, really, you know, low top type things. So, you know, definitely something to keep an eye on. And so I wanted to show, unfortunately, no, I won't be able to show the loop here, so I'll skip over that. But this is just an example of the event yesterday that we had where Rapid City had a couple of reports of 3-inch hail. There's a 3-inch hail report here at that mouse point, and then a 3-inch report here. But looking at the mesh values for that, they were really only, you know, 1.5, maybe 1.75, right around in there. So really didn't pick up on that idea that there was a potential for 3-inch hail. So, you know, it just kind of ties into, and, you know, Rapid City was mentioning the larger hail in there. So, you know, it ties into kind of keeping an eye on, making sure you're watching, you know, the radar data and looking at the radar data, because the meshes, you know, can be a good guide, but it's not, may not pick up on things perfectly. Zooming into or doing a look at Aberdeen's area, we had that same storm kind of go across the southern part of our area. There's a couple interesting things just kind of comparing the storm reports versus the mesh. We had mesh values up over 2-inch, even a couple picks of the 2.5-inch hail. We never got a, you know, larger hail report than 1-inch with that event, you know, probably just because of the location of where it was at. But this event here, we got a 1-inch hail report, but the mesh value there was only 0.1. So it makes me wonder if maybe it was just maybe displaced a little bit, you know, maybe could have been up with this storm, you know, this where the storms kind of split off there and, you know, located a little farther north. Another one is this 2.75-inch hail. I think when I sampled that, the mesh all around that area was only 0.6, but the LSR was actually mentioning windshields being broken in cars and stuff, and it actually was close to one of the towns, so we're wondering if maybe they were driving through this larger, you know, mesh swath, and then kind of it didn't get really reported until they got into town or, you know, closer to some cell phone towers or something like that. But, you know, it kind of makes you wonder if that is something that could have been maybe a little farther to the south. But, you know, you look at some of the other things, you know, you have 1-inch hail, 1.75, 1-inch, you know, a lot of that matches up with anywhere in the green is greater than 1-inch hail. So it seemed to match up fairly well overall. So with that, just, you know, a couple of things about using the mesh in the warning operations. You know, I think the strengths of it is it's another tool. It can definitely help you kind of with your warning process, help you with your confidence. If you're seeing, you know, mesh values really increase and it's corresponding with the way the radar trends are, you know, I think that just helps, you know, build your confidence to include higher hail amounts in the warnings. But, you know, the key is it just can't be good radar interrogation. There's a lot of, you know, limitations and concerns, and we even ran into it yesterday. I was, you know, looking at those storms yesterday, and we were seeing a 10 to 20 minute delay or even dropouts where we were missing some of the MRMS data. So, you know, it's not something you want to, you know, really rely on. I think that kind of ties into some of the issues that they're having with Prob Severe too, with, you know, the Prob Severe dropouts, because Prob Severe was also dropping out yesterday at around the same time when we were seeing those, the mesh dropouts. So I don't know if it's something at INSEP with the MRMS or how that all is going on. But, you know, just be aware that it's, you know, if you're doing good radar interrogation, you're going to do pretty well. And, you know, this can kind of help you build your confidence. So, you know, kind of bouncing back to the original question, can it help the warning forecaster? I think it can, as long as you're aware of the limitations. And, you know, my big recommendation, if you're starting to see, you know, several pixels or a larger area of 2-inch plus mesh values, definitely consider adding at least golf ball or, you know, for sure, or maybe even trend towards the 2-inch hail. And that kind of increases that wording in the impact-based warnings. You know, we hear a lot more. It seems like we hear more with the tied into the tornado threats and tags and stuff. But, you know, it's the same thing with the hail sizes. You kind of ramp up that wording and with the IBW. So, you know, to me, I think of it, it's like if I saw a warning with 1-inch hail, I may kind of be a little iffy on if I want to run out, actually go outside and move the car. But if you get a 2-inch in the warning, you know, you're going to take a whole lot more action from that versus maybe a 1-inch hail. So, with that, I think that is pretty much all I had. I apologize for the issues at the beginning, and if you guys have any questions, let me know.
I guess you wowed us here in Bismarck, Steve. We don't have any questions. That's great stuff, though. I think we've been looking at the MRMS stuff a little more closely with the two events that we've had this week, and seems like it's definitely helping us out, especially compared to some of the algorithms, even from GR. We've kind of noticed that MRMS seems to match much better than the GR output, the single radar.
Yeah. I've been trying, at least these first couple events that we've had here, I want to, now that I'm getting, the full, detailed resolution and timing, I've been trying to kind of keep track of how things have been going for our first, I guess we're up to 14 warnings now or 15 warnings or so. So I'm going to try and keep track of some of that throughout the season. Maybe I can kind of update some of the data and stuff.
So thanks, Steve, for having us on this dual webinar. I think this is kind of a neat little science sharing thing that we have here. And as Steve was mentioning, I also presented this at the Northern Plains Workshop in Grand Forks a few weeks ago. And what we're looking at is sort of a climatology of the convection allowing model, and I say storm attribute fields in the title of this talk. And, I think we're all used to looking at the high-res models, the HER, the SPC SSEO, which is what I'm going to talk about mostly in today's talk. But I don't know if we're really well calibrated to what some of that output means. And that's what I wanted to focus on with this particular research. So just to start us off, a little bit of a review about convection allowing models. I think we're all pretty familiar with them, like I said, the HERs and that sort of thing. But just to take us back a step for a moment, of course, the big difference between the something like the GFS that we look at and these high-resolution convection-allowing models is that we're actually allowing them to produce convection. So in other words, the 12-kilometer GFS that we looked at, it's both a higher or rather a lower grid scale spacing, so 12 kilometers versus, say, a 3 or 4 kilometers grid spacing that we have with the HER and the models that go into the SPC SSEO, like the WARFs, the high-resolution WARFs. So it's different grid spacing. But moreover, the GFS, of course, parameterizes convection. So the model sort of has a lot of different things that go into it that say, okay, there's convection at this particular grid box, but it's not really allowing the convection processes to truly occur. It's just sort of accounting for them in a parameterized type of way. That's why we'd get things like grid scale feedback from the GFS over the years. Well, when we look at these high-resolution models, of course, the 4-kilometer grid spacing or less, you can actually get high enough resolution to turn off that convective parameterization and actually let the model produce convection in that particular grid box and deal with latent heat release and things like that. That's the cool thing, and that's why we get to see these really high-resolution sort of simulated storm reflectivity signatures and things like that. But one thing that we don't necessarily always think about when we start talking about convection-allowing models is that there's still differences in the microphysics schemes from model to model, say from the HER to one of the NCEP WARFs or something like that, and boundary layer parameterization. So even though, like I said, we turn off the convective parameterization for these high-res models, we're still parameterizing the processes that are going on in the planetary boundary layer because we're still not at a scale where we can really do that, and there's also still a lot of uncertainty that goes on in the boundary layer processes. So those are all still parameterized in these models, and we look at different model cores, say the HER or the NCEP WARF ARW or the Severe Storms Lab WARF ARW, they all have just a little bit different schemes for the boundary layer parameterization, and a lot of times the microphysics schemes, and when I say microphysics schemes, I'm talking a lot about what the model is allowed to do as far as ice in the cloud and that sort of thing, how many different types of hydrometeors perhaps can show up in the high-resolution model. So we all know there's many flavors of these. The Storm Prediction Center Storm Scale Ensemble of Opportunity, the SSEO, it sort of combines several of these. And just for a short review of that, the SSEO, it actually uses several different models, and it kind of produces a poor man's ensemble. So the different members that are in there are the Severe Storms Laboratory, WARF ARW, that's sort of considered the gold standard when it comes to convection-allowing models from the research community. That particular WARF ARW, which is the advanced research component or flavor of the WARF, has been pretty steady state with how they have their configuration for a number of years. They really haven't changed the microphysics schemes or the boundary layer parameterizations from what they've had set, or if they have, it's been very minimal. And a lot of the research community, especially when you start talking storm chase community, if you go to the hazardous weather testbed and talk to folks, that's the model they really, really like. There's several other members, and of course, in the SSEO, and you go on down the list and you get to some of the things like the EMC WARF NMM. Well, That particular model is a different core of the ARW, of the WRF, rather. That one tends to be a little hyperactive. We see that one produce, you know, deeper convection over a larger area, typically just from a subjective view and from an objective view. From Aaron Kennedy, as a researcher at the University of North Dakota, he's done some work on this that actually explicitly says that, yeah, the NMM does produce deeper convection over a wider area than, say, the Nissel WRF ARW. Well, the SSEO, combining all of these, there's some thought, there's some research that's been done. SPC pointed out in one of the conference preceding papers that they produced a few years ago that the SSEO probably does really well because it's sort of, much like Superblend, kind of balances out the two opposite extremes. The Nissel WRF, I said, is sort of the gold standard. It does well, but it's probably conservative with output as far as developing deeper storms. So you balance all of these things in this SSEO, you probably get a pretty good result, and that's sort of Superblend-esque, if you will. And, of course, the other members that we're producing in here are sort of time-lagged. We're looking at the previous runs of the ARW and that sort of thing. One other little thing that I want to just touch on briefly is if you look at the NSEP WRF ARW, that's basically the same setup as the Nissel WRF, but we're looking at different boundary conditions. They're starting with the RAP as opposed to the NAM for the boundary conditions. So that's sort of why you get some differences in there. Like I said, all high-resolution models not the same. There's little differences that you can put in. We're probably all familiar with the output from the SSEO. You can get the hourly maximum fields. You can also get neighborhood probabilities driven from all seven of those members. In other words, if you have, you know, seven out of seven members in a certain 40-kilometer grid box producing a certain field, say reflectivity greater than 40 dB, that would be 100% neighborhood probability for that particular grid box. And you sort of spread them out over a neighborhood, hence the term. Stepping one step further into that, updraft helicity, which is what I'm going to focus on a lot in this little talk, is really a diagnostic for tracking rotation in simulated storms. You start getting into the math, and you're really actually using integrals, which I haven't used since my days at UND, but you're taking the integral of vertical vorticity, and then you're multiplying it by the updraft velocity over a certain layer. Usually we're integrating between 2 and 5 kilometers AGL. You'll see some output if you go to the web, different places where you can get low level, like 0 to 3 AGL updraft helicity. But generally speaking, for a lot of the things in what the SSEO is looking at is that sort of 2 to 5 kilometer layer, and the maximum in that layer in particular is what we're interested in. Some research has been done to say supercells are possible if you get updraft helicity greater than about 25 meters squared per second squared. And then Adam Clark et al. In 2012 produced a paper in Weather and Forecasting that said tornado path lengths are actually kind of correlated with updraft helicity values greater than about 100. So this is definitely one of those things where the higher the value you get, supposedly, theoretically, the better potential is for some higher order magnitude severe weather. And it should, in general, though, be viewed as a predictor of organized updraft. So just because you have a updraft helicity of 25 doesn't necessarily mean you've got a supercell, but certainly a hint at an organized updraft, a better probability of a supercell. So if we look at a real event viewed in SPC SSEO, the upper left-hand panel in this is the maximum 25-hour updraft helicity from any of the seven members that are in the SSEO. The upper right panel, is I just pulled out one of the members. It happened to be that WRF NMM member. It's the 1 kilometer AGL reflectivity, valid at 23Z in this particular event from the past. And you can see a pretty good little hoop echo there. So the reflectivity signature suggests, sure, there's a supercell possible in this particular model. The lower left is the 24-hour probability of updraft helicity greater than 25, and again, that's from all those members in a neighborhood approach. And then the lower right is the same probability for updraft helicity greater than 100. The thing that should really jump out at you at this particular event is in the upper left, the 24-hour max updraft helicity from any member is really extreme. And from southeast Montana and in particular across northwest South Dakota, we see values that are pegged out at 500. That's the max that you can get. That's where they cap it off in these particular instances. So ahead of this event, and this was something that we looked at when I was in the Billings office, leading up to this particular event, and we saw this updraft helicity signature and said, wow, 500, you know, that's really something, but we didn't really know, you know, how often do values of 500 meters squared per second squared really come out of the SSEO? Does that really mean anything? Does it mean like we think, you know, just like we see a 5,000 cape, does that really mean that, you know, that's going to be something, you know, extra severe is going to happen that day? So we weren't quite too sure leading up to this event what was going to happen. Well, what did happen, actually, this was the strongest tornado that's been recorded in the Billings CWA. It was an EF3 with a 10-mile path length. It was on the ground for about 60 minutes or so. I believe Ryan from the Aberdeen office chased this particular storm, and he shared a whole bunch of pictures with us when we were in the Billings office of this. The damage photos are a little deceiving, perhaps. That lower left image, I believe, was the old schoolhouse, probably not well anchored for sure, and probably not very well developed. But there was enough damage, especially to some trees, because it kind of went into the Custer National Forest to give us an EF3 rating on this particular tornado, which was the first and only EF3 damage in the Billings area. So that kind of made us go, wow, there might be something to this whole updraft helicity thing that leading up to this. That was the SSEO run from the night before, and that's kind of what motivated what I'm going to show you from here on out. So how often do you really get that 500 meters squared per second squared updraft helicity from the SSEO? Does it occur a number of times a year? Is it a rare thing? We didn't know. And then, you know, falling out from that, is there a correlation between that updraft helicity and or updraft speed, which is a different diagnostic that we can pull out of the storm scale model? Is there a correlation between those things and severe weather reports or intensity? And really, can we use the SSEO to kind of help calibrate our severe weather outlooks? So a number of questions that we kind of looked at here. So what we did is we went back and we looked at all of the 0Z SSEO runs, and it's centered on the northwestern high plains. And the reason being is I started this research when I was over at the Billings office last year, and because we kind of were centered on that Carter County EF3 tornado event. So the area in red there is the study area. So it's the Glasgow and Billings CWAs. It's down into the Rapid City CWA. And then it goes across into the western and parts of the central Dakotas. And what I did is I looked at all the 0Z runs of the SSEO for two warm seasons, basically, April through the end of September 2014-2015, ended up with just shy of 370 different individual cases. There's probably a few events where there might have been SSEO runs missing or that sort of thing. And I analyzed updraft helicity and updraft speed. And then I compared to severe weather reports ultimately, which is what I will show in a little while here. And when I looked at this, when I looked as a sort of a caveat, the 2015 events, when I first did this work, I had to use sort of the preliminary LSRs kind of for some of the events, I think especially after July 30th. Of last year, so there might be just a little caveat there. I included thunderstorm wind damage in addition to any kind of hail or tornado reports, but I did not include funnel cloud reports for severe weather stuff as we go on and compare in the next few slides. So first of all, what does a sort of a model climatology of updraft speed look like? And this is the 24-hour maximum updraft speed from any member over any portion of that domain, so anywhere in the red area from the previous slide. The bottom left of this chart is individual dates, basically starting again from way back in early April 2014 and then all the ending in the end of September 2015. We skipped the winter months, of course, just did warm season. The left is the maximum updraft speed going up. And you can see occasionally we get updraft values greater than about 25 meters squared per second squared, but relatively infrequently. And you can sort of see, of course, a sort of typical climatological pattern to this where you see peaks occurring generally in June of the last 2 years, and sort of you can see the day-to-day variation, of course. Well, what if we look at the maximum updraft helicity from any member? Same sort of thing. But interestingly, there's a lot less day-to-day variability of updraft helicity than there is with just the updraft speed. The graph kind of smooths out, if you will. We see some days here where it definitely gets above, 100, and we kind of see a lot fewer days where it gets above 200. You can see just a couple of spikes there in this two-year climatology where the updraft helicity from any member, again, got up above about 200 or so. So the maximum, this is sort of the frequency on this particular slide of maximum updraft helicity values, kind of broke it out a little bit. And it turns out that, yeah, values over about 25 are relatively infrequent in the model climatology, and that's a good thing since we sort of use that 25 number as our baseline for when a supercell might be possible or a more organized updraft. Only 35% of the warm season days in that, northwestern high plains region have a maximum updraft helicity from any of the seven members in the SSEO greater than about 25. The other thing that sort of jumps out at you in this is that if you go above about 100 maximum updraft helicity on the bottom of this chart, the frequency, and I apologize that the white's a little hard to see on this screen, but the numbers, there's only about 11 of them that fall in or to that 125 bank, for instance, and you start getting way up above 200, again, you see pretty rare instances of updraft helicity getting to that value. if we break this out to updraft helicity greater than only 200 on that domain from any of the members, 50% of those events actually brought more than 50 severe weather reports over the domain in the following day. And this is the 0Z, again, SSEO run. So we're essentially, if you're looking at a typical diurnal variation of the severe reports, you're looking at a 18 to, you know, 30-hour lead time, basically, on these sort of things. And the it turns out the June 17th, 2014 event, which was that Carter County EF3 event, that was the maximum updraft helicity in the domain for the last 2 years. That was the only event that had a max updraft helicity of 500 for many of the members. And interestingly enough, sort of related to that, chatting with some of the folks from SIMS, the severe SIMS group down at SPC and in the Norman test bed, the Moore Oklahoma tornado from 2013, May 20th of 2013, was a pretty well-advertised event, and the Nissel Wharf in particular and some of this SSEO stuff did really well with that. But he pointed out to me, or they pointed out to us, that they were intrigued by this Southern Montana event because even that event did not have an updraft helicity from the model show up at 500, whereas this particular event did, which was kind of interesting. But if you kind of go down the line, you maybe pick out an event or two that stands out as being a big event for the last couple years, and you see that they, you know, that particular, that June 19th, 2015 event over the domain, 145 different severe reports, with a maximum updraft helicity for many of the members of 400. So pretty good correlation between severe reports, just kind of gauging by this. That June 19th event that I just mentioned, it actually included a EF2 tornado, 6-inch diameter hailstones near Rapid City, or just north of Rapid City. Same layout here, the upper left panel is the maximum 24-hour updraft helicity from any of the members. And in this particular case, it pegged out or maxed out just over 400, or right around 400 from any of the members in northeast Wyoming. The probability of updraft helicity greater than 100 in the upper right panel there, you see really kind of, it really jumps out at you as being in that, you know, 70% kind of range over that northeast Wyoming corner. So in other words, 70% of the SSEO members had an updraft helicity greater than 100 showing up. So really good model agreement that there's going to be really strong rotating updrafts ahead of this event. We do see, if you look at the storm reports in the lower left-hand corner there, there's a sort of an offset. The severe reports are tended to be just to the north and the east of where those updraft helicity tracks were actually pegged from 24 hours period. So it's certainly not a necessarily a worn-on forecast kind of thing. You have to sort of consider the mesoscale environment. But on the whole, that should sort of raise a red flag, at least in this case, that the updraft helicity, oh, there's a really big updraft helicity value, the higher end severe report's kind of possible. And then the lower right-hand corner, that kind of shows you the evolution towards the evening. That supercell out ahead of there was the one that really produced the really high-end 6-inch diameter hailstones, wind-driven, by the way, too. In contrast to that, there was an event from July 5th of this year where there was really early day outflow that kind of pushed the threat further south and east. We saw, you know, a probability of updraft helicity greater, in this case, of 10 to 20% you see in the far right-hand side over towards the Aberdeen CWA, or in the Aberdeen CWA, where there's a 20% probability of greater than 100 updraft helicity. So in other words, probably two of the members in the SSEO pegged updraft helicity values of that great in that general area. And you see the max on the upper left panel there, updraft helicity. There is a track or two that have values probably greater than 100, but it turns out that the severe reports in this particular case in the lower left, right along the Nebraska-South Dakota line and then further southeast, and what happened is the 0Z SSEO didn't capture outflow that came from storms that developed over Montana the night before that really surged the frontal zone much further south and east. So it goes back to mesoscale meteorology, especially when you're looking at a model run from the night before. You still have to kind of consider those other potential failure modes, if you will, from this standpoint. Again, it's not perfect, but certainly this was one of the cases where it did sort of fail because of some mesoscale things that were hard to model. So one of the questions we asked from this research was, is there a correlation between the max updraft speed and the total event reports, again, on the entire domain, that whole red area of that northwestern high plains that we looked at in one of the early slides? And if we look at maximum updraft speed on the lower part of this graph and the total severe reports on the domain, we do see a little positive correlation. The R-squared value there, it's really not significant. You certainly see a little general uptick as the updraft speed, maximum updraft speed from any of the members increases. The total number of severe reports generally does kind of increase, but we don't necessarily see a good correlation. In contrast to that, if we look at the max updraft helicity and the total severe reports, we see a much different R-squared value. It's much better correlation between event reports than updraft speed. So one of the takeaways from this would be that updraft helicity would probably be a better diagnostic to look for if you're looking for severe reports coverage-wise and probably intensity. The total number of reports definitely increases as you go up with updraft helicity values. Again, it's not perfect. You can see some of the 100 values there of updraft helicity certainly are probably down around zero reports. That does happen, like that event we just looked at. But in general, you do see an upward tick. And a probabilistic approach is better than a single model max updraft helicity. That last slide that I showed was the max updraft helicity from any member. This looks at the probability, the neighborhood probability of updraft helicity greater than 100. And if we look at that compared to the total number of severe reports, we get an even better R-squared value. Not that it's all just about the R-squared value, but certainly the correlation improves a little bit more. And interestingly, there was only one event in the 2 years' worth of data that had less than 20 reports if you had a 20% or greater probability of max updraft helicity greater than 100. So in other words, anytime you had two or more of the members from the SSEO suggesting higher end type of rotational signatures from the model, you generally had 20 or more reports on the regional kind of scale. And about that case that had 20% updraft helicity greater than 100 but less than 20 events. Well, this was it. It was from back in June of 2014. And did it really have less than 20 events? Well, maybe not, actually. This was our outlier case, but what you see is the far southwestern corner of South Dakota and that left-hand panel just touches the 20% probability of updraft helicity greater than 100. And so it was included in that particular subset of events. But if you look at the right-hand panel, which is the storm event reports, there were only a handful of reports, eight in fact, in the Rapid City warning area from this particular case. But what you do see is down in Nebraska, this ended up being actually a late-day high-risk upgrade with a ratio that kind of progressed through Nebraska. And so it's sort of by using the neighborhood approach and being a strict, you know, sort of study as far as looking at our domain, this event fell in there. But really, it probably did sort of verify in the sense, just not on our domain. We did really see a high-end kind of report that was just outside of the South Dakota where the border was in our domain. So again, thinking about it from a neighborhood approach and probabilistically, I ran through a whole bunch of other correlations to test this to see which might be significant. I, you know, looked at things like event reports versus maximum updraft speed, updraft helicity we looked at, but not only that, I looked at things like tornadoes versus the maximum updraft helicity. We saw in the earlier paper that Adam Clark's et al. Had some, you know, correlation between updraft helicity and tornado event reports. It turns out that in our data set, that's really not a very good discriminator, probably because a lot of our events in the study domain, you know, are going to be supercells that have high or in environments of low boundary layer moisture, so we're just not going to see the tornado probability be higher. So a lot of those things, and even we looked at 2-inch hail reports versus updraft helicity greater than 100, and there certainly was a correlation there, but none of them were as good as just looking at the probability of updraft helicity greater than 100 related to severe reports. And so that really is an SSEO field that forecasters should be paying attention to. That's the big one of the big takeaways from this particular research. Sort of the next step in this research is, you know, what type of environments really drive what I'm calling extreme updraft helicity values greater than 300. This goes back to our Carter County EF3, that Southern Montana EF3 tornado event. And again, this was the one that had the highest updraft helicity in the study, 500. And that's what you see in the upper left-hand panel there is from the SSEO. And the question is, what really drove that? And we don't really know. Sort of to take a stab at it, we looked at the SPC mesoscale analysis effective late in the afternoon near the time of the storms. And this would be a really strong assumption that what happened in the SPC mesoscale analysis is really what the model was predicting the night before. I don't have a good way of knowing that right offhand for this initial version of this study, but we saw a really strongly unstable environment, you know, 4,000 cape and 40 knots of effective shear in this particular case is what verified whether the model was predicting a similar environment or not. I'm not sure in this particular case, but that maybe gives us an idea what drives these extreme events. We can compare with the July 21st, 2014 event, which ended up being a substantial QLCS that went across much of North Dakota. It started in the west end of the domain that I was looking at, so it showed up as being one of the higher-end max 24-hour updraft helicity cases. It gets up there above, well above 200. This particular case, again, had a really an extreme most unstable cape verifying from the mesoscale analysis, 5,000 joules, and the effective bulk wind shear was 30 or 40 knots, not a high-end shear environment, but a high-end cape environment. Again, we're really comparing apples and oranges here, but it was sort of a first step to kind of say, what kind of environments maybe drive these high-end updraft helicity signatures? Because I don't think we really know, and that's probably the next step in all of this. So if you're going to have some key points to remember, some takeaways to walk away, updraft helicity values from the SSEO greater than 300 meters squared per second squared, like the Carter County case that we saw, they really are rare. You're only going to see them about 1% of the time, so from any member. So if you see something like that from the SPC SSEO, if you're on the mid shift or the day shift, you know, getting ready for severe weather, that should definitely jump out at you that there's higher potential, perhaps, regardless of what the SPC outlook suggests. Usually they're going to follow along with this sort of thing, but it might be another little hint to kind of sway you in the certain direction. Updraft speed, not necessarily the most useful predictor, but updraft helicity is, and if you're looking for probabilistic kind of approach, values greater than 20% of greater than 100 meters squared per second squared, they're really strongly correlated with 20-plus report events. So that should be, again, something that jumps out at you as a potential operationally useful tidbit. So this is just sort of the start of some work. We really need more statistically robust results, of course. And what we really want to do in the future is use the NISL WARF ARW core to kind of do something similar to what I did with the SSEO. So one thing that happened in this 2 years of study from 2014 to 2015 is, well, NSET made some changes to their WARFs that are part of the SSEO. So those model cores and things that I talked about early on, they made subtle changes to, you know, their parameterizations and things like that. So really, in a sense, we're kind of comparing apples and oranges just from the 2 years of this study, which doesn't necessarily make it the most robust result, because some of the results might have changed as far as what's driving updraft helicity values from year to year. We don't know, but they might have. I mentioned or alluded to early on that the NISL WARF ARW, which is kind of the gold standard in convective modeling, and it also hasn't changed their configuration in a number of years. So looking at just that model would probably be a good way, especially if we want to start seeing what kind of environments are driving these really high-end updraft helicity values. That would be sort of the way to go to. And it just so happens that the Severe Storms Laboratory has a really good database of all of those WARF simulations back to about 2007 or 2008 with their stable model configuration. And they have it, and the University of North Dakota has that same database from the Severe Storms Laboratory. They're willing to share it with us so we can kind of expand this research in the future. And what we really want to do, again, is kind of compare those model environments. And then ultimately, what would be kind of neat to do is we have the ensemble situational awareness table that we use now from the GFS ensemble to kind of give us an idea how rare a certain thing is from the model output. We could perhaps eventually develop automatic return intervals and percentile output for sort of on-demand calibration for updraft helicity values or whatever other output we might want to look at for forecasters, very similar to that particular situational awareness table. So that's all I have. If anyone has any questions, I would be happy to answer them.
Hey, Chauncy, this is Phil in Sioux Falls.
Yes.
Hey, just a quick question. Given the population issues that exist in the Northwest Plains, did you happen to look at, I know it's a little tough to do, but the aerial coverage of reports versus the, you know, probability of greater than 100 or whatever, just thinking that maybe it went through some areas that didn't have a high population, but if you had reports over a large part of the domain, even though they may be 20 or 30, that may also provide a better correlation as well.
Yeah, I'm glad you bring that up, and I didn't necessarily consider specifically some of those population issues. They're definitely there, and I think you kind of alluded to another thing that does crop up on this is a lot of the results are sort of related to the domain size. I think a few slides ago I showed that one event that was sort of the null case, and there were a few handful of events that were sort of back in Montana, and then there was a handful of events, a separate sort of, severe episode that was in far southern South Dakota. I think a total of 8 reports on the domain, but all 8 of those reports did go into just that correlation for that particular day. So even though they were sort of 2 different episodes and entirely separate geographic areas. So definitely one of the next steps with this would be to sort of kind of start to try and wrap our hands around, our arms around some of those issues geographically on the domain. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, mostly. Like I said, you know, I wonder, if you get a chance, it would really be interesting to know if the higher end days not only have more reports, but also a wider geographic spread across them, too.
Certainly, yeah. That's definitely a next step to kind of start to take a look at. And if I do kind of start to look at that, I will definitely share those results with you.
Yeah, I'd definitely be interested. Thanks.
Thanks, Phil. Anyone else have any questions? All right. Well, if not, I'll turn it back over to Steve, and thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, thanks, Chauncy. That was great. It was good to kind of review it again. Just, you know, seeing the second time, I catch a couple things that I didn't catch the first time. So, yeah, thank you very much for doing that and for the idea to put this together. So. Cool. Well, thanks.
All right. We'll talk to you guys later.
Talk to you later.